It's a word politicians have not always embraced, but these days, it's hard to ignore.
I'm a nationalist, okay? I'm a nationalist. Use that word. Use that word.
And world leaders are now addressing it head on.
Le nationalisme en est la trahison.
French President Emmanuel Macron called nationalism a betrayal of patriotism. And our Prime Minister had similar warnings this week.
When people feel their institutions can't protect them, they look for easy answers in populism, in nationalism.
Former Prime Minister Stephen Harper is also weighing in, calling their concerns an example of disconnected elitism.
So which one is it? And what, more importantly, are the consequences of those kinds of messages? Chantal Hébert is in Montreal tonight. Andrew Coyne is in Calgary tonight. And André Domise is in Toronto. Good to see everybody. Andrew, I'm going to start with you because you wrote about this week. You thought about it. We're all going to think about it now. But what, in your mind, was Macron warning against? Nationalism, something that he's seen before? What was he trying to wake everybody up to, do you think?
Well, there's a kind of nationalism that we've seen in the past and in the present that's divisive, that's intolerant, that's based upon definitions of people based on their ethnicity or their race or their religion or things that are, to a great degree, immutable, and that very easily can be turned against outsiders or indeed in people in their midst who don't fit that particular mold. And we are seeing that certainly in Europe, the kind of an ethnic-based nationalism, certainly a nationalism that's very hostile to outside forces. We're seeing a version of that in the United States, certainly hostile to foreign, treaties and alliances, and its very worst, white nationalism or racism, to give it a simpler word. So those kinds of things are certainly very worrisome. I think one has to be careful not throwing everything out together, though. There's a version of nationalism that can be quite positive. The nationalism that says, we need to widen our boundaries. We need to be look past our internal differences and realize what we have in common as a nation, and directing that towards good purposes. It's trying to achieve great things together. That kind of nationalism, often called civic nationalism, can be a positive thing, can inspire people to very high ideals, and shouldn't be dismissed lightly. So I think it's a question of differentiating between good and bad nationalism. I should also say I don't think you should just dismiss critics and critiques of nationalism as just being elitism, as Stephen Harper's trying. I think Macron was trying to make a serious and sober message.
Well, and we can talk more about why he said that or whether there's anything to that. But Chantal, is it a danger to have this existing within you, or as Andrews points out, is there a side to it that is good and healthy and positive and something you want to see in a country?
I think it's dangerous to take a label like nationalism and decide that it's suddenly equated automatically with racism. And I think Canada, and until recently, throughout its presidencies, our countries where civic nationalism has had pride of place, and I see no reason for that to change. But the context is really different. If you want to go to where nationalism became a more scary word in Europe post Second World War,
yes,
you need to look at what happened in the former Yugoslavia. And I think that kind of poisoned the well of the word nationalism. And then there is the rise. Don't forget, Emmanuel Macron, the French president, beat Marine Le Pen, someone who practices ethnic nationalism bordering or crossing into racism. So the context is really different.
Yeah, and he was saying those words on the 100th anniversary of the armistice, because there's a belief that, of course, that was also gave rise to World War, the First World War and the Second World War. But he was also saying, at some belief, not just because Donald Trump was in the audience, but because of all the real dangers in Europe of these kinds of leaders as well. So, André, would you say that it is a danger in Canada? Whatever Macron is warning against, is there something to that here?
It can be a danger in Canada. I think we've, when we've seen attacks from, organizations like the MUD, we have to take that seriously, or organizations like Sons of Odin. But I take exception to the idea that what Macron said in his speech was that patriotism is the opposite of nationalism. I find that completely ridiculous. And I think part of what drives this nationalism that he's talking about is people feeling like the wool's been pulled over their eyes. When Stephen Harper refers to the elites, he's not talking about rich people like his friends. He's talking about people who occupy high sociopolitical status who believe that they know better for the average person and they know for themselves. And when you say something like patriotism is the opposite of nationalism, the root word of patriotism is patris, which is a Greek word that means fatherland. Mm-hmm. Nationalism is simply the kinship that people feel between one another within national borders and to some extent, in an ethnic sense. And the reason that people turn towards these ideologies is because the economic model that we have now that encourages the growth of capital, encourages the distribution and transfer of capital, but restricts the growth and distribution of people, that we can't move across geographic borders, we can't move across economic classes. Mm-hmm. When you have that kind of a restriction, they're going to turn to some very dangerous ideas, and I think that's what we're seeing.
Okay, so Andrew, I mean, talk about, so that we can sort of bring it down back to earth, if we can, this conversation, what then should people make of us, of these things being bandied about? Practically, what does that mean for them? Is it what Andre's talking about, that people feel disconnected, left behind, falling through the cracks, as Stephen Harper sort of, I think, is trying to get at there?
Well, the germ of truth in all this critique is that when so many problems now involve transnational questions, whether you're talking about climate change or agreement on how to deal with refugees or
trade,
you know, there's a range of these issues that now cross international borders, require a lot of international cooperation. And it's very easy to lose sight of the fact that the organizations that we're setting up that cross these international boundaries don't have a democratic mandate. Nobody elected people to the WTO, for example, to deal with world trade. So it's not completely wrong for people to say when you know some verdict is rendered by the WTO, wait a minute, I didn't vote for them. Who are they to tell us how we can run our affairs? So the more ambitious we've become to try and deal with these international matters through international cooperation, the more we're running into this kind of democratic deficit question. That's not easily resolved, and it can't just be dismissed. But I come back to this point that the answer to that is not going to be withdrawing within ourselves. I think it's going to be trying to democratize our own processes as countries to try and give people more assurance that people are listening to them, that listening to their concerns. I would make one point in defense of Macron is I think what he was getting at is the nationalism that is defensible is a nationalism that is aimed towards some kind of moral purpose that's aimed towards high ideals, to achieving things together as a nation for ourselves in our own country and for the world at large. That is easily aligned with patriotism because you're trying to do what's best for your country. When nationalism just becomes, oh, we're different, we're separate from, we don't want to have anything to do with other nations, then I think you're retreating from those moral ambitions and those high ideals.
And yet that seems to be what's happening in more places than just the United States, Chantal.
Yes, but in more places than the United States takes away from the core problem, which is that the United States used to have some kind of leadership mm-hmm. on issues like that and be a model for a different kind of nationalism. This notion that all boats rise when you rise your own. And the America first, the rest of the world is looking to take advantage of us, which is the kind of discourse that you've been hearing in the U.S. From the White House, mm-hmm. goes against the grain and takes away a role that the U.S., since the Second World War at least, had played, not always well, but had played.
So, Andre, you react to that then. Where does that leave us then?
Well, to your point, Chantel, the phrase normally goes, rising tide lifts all boats. But I think what people have been seeing, especially over the last 30, 35 years, is that the rising tide has been lifting yachts. And the failure of the center and the center left to articulate a vision for a model that gets away from people's wages and their lives being essentially stagnant, while the upper class continue to get richer, while multinational corporations can, let's say, stomp through Queens and get billions of dollars in concessions when the city can't even make the trains run on time. If you can't articulate a model that's contrary to that, then they're going to turn to some very dangerous ideas.
I think what's happening particularly in recent years is this alignment of nationalism and populism. And what you've got is this very toxic brew post 9/11, post financial crisis, et cetera, where elites are in bad odor, where people, it's very, very popular now to go out and denounce elites. And when you say...
Even when you are an elite.
Well, oftentimes when you are an elite, that's right. But when the elites are also connected to these kind of international bodies, it's particularly in Europe, of course, where you've got the European Union trying to achieve, to take more powers away from national governments, people pushing back against that, and they've got new fuel for their fire, if you will, post-financial crisis, and of course with this, with the refugee crisis in Europe, where decisions are being made, I think, in good faith and with the best purposes in mind, but nevertheless not necessarily always connecting to the democratic voice of the people in those countries as to how many refugees they're going to take in, et cetera. Some people are going to react badly to that, and I think that's part of what's adding fuel to this fire.
And Chantal, you can close us off on how our government then is dealing with it, given the kinds of things that Justin Trudeau was saying this week.
I think that's too tall an order for me to address, but I would just say this. I think that one of the ways that you fight this is not necessarily the central left having suddenly a vision that makes people who feel left behind feel better, but have institutions, starting with education, but others, that mean that your kids, no matter how you feel, can aspire to be the elite. And I think that in Canada, for all that I've heard over the past 5 minutes, that is still possible. Part of the reason is we have kept higher education accessible, and those kind of policies, and the fact that people can partake in society and aspire to become better. I think that dream is still livable and attainable in Canada, and we do a disservice to ourselves to sit there and pretend that we have the problems of a society, for instance, like France, where it is very hard still to this day to move from one social class to another.
Okay, I gotta leave it there. Thank you, everyone. I know we just probably skimmed the surface, but you did a good job. Andrew, Chantal, and Andre.